Welcome to the Common Good Podcast, a conversation about the significance of place, eliminating economic isolation, and the structure of belonging. My name is Rabbi Miriam Turlenchamp, and I'm your host. For this week's episode, Joey Taylor speaks with Amaha Sellassie about the Gem City Market, West Dayton Strong, and his article, Beloved Community is a Present Possibility. Amaha Sellassie is a peace builder, social healer, freedom fighter, network weaver, and lover of humanity. Amaha serves as president of the Gem City Market Cooperative Board of Directors. He's an associate professor of sociology and director of Center for Applied Social Issues at Sinclair Community College in Dayton, Ohio. He begins the conversation by defining what beloved community is.
I think beloved community to me is, how do we ground ourselves in human dignity? All humans have the same dignity, and it's inescapable, and there's no hierarchy of dignity. It just is. And so from that standpoint, like, how do we create spaces of belonging? We have different ideas, different opinions, coming from different backgrounds, different cultures, but fundamentally, we're all human. And so how do we ground ourselves in the space of being human? I think also within it, how do we build a people-oriented society versus a thing-oriented society? How does capital be subject to humanity instead of humanity subject to capital? To try to like create the space of belonging, ultimately, where we acknowledge the dignity and worth of every human being. I think the Gem City Market, actually cooperatives in general, but the Gem City Market in particular, is a tool or a catalyst for a more beloved community. It gives us a place to practice community. People come in from all different walks of life. We're connecting, we're building deeper relationships, because trust is ultimately what's needed to emerge more of a beloved community. And that comes through deeper relationships. And so it gives us a place to practice. Even in the building of the market, Dayton's hyper-segregated. 98% of African Americans live on the west side. 94% of white live on the east side with the Turkish, Latino, and African refugee community. But the entire region came together to build this market, and we got 5,000 members. I think it's like finding ways to work together across differences to realize our humanity and build deeper connections. So I think co-ops do that in general, actually. To me, part of beloved community is being rooted in love. That's the foundation. And then from being rooted in love, it's acknowledging our interdependence, that we're not independent things, but that we're actually have a social self, that we are interdependent, or King would call it a single garment of destiny, that we're in an inescapable web of mutuality. In African philosophy, they'll say Ubuntu, that I am because we are. I can't be my full humanity until you are in your full humanity. So it's a notion that we have a social body. We have our individual parts, but we actually comprise something else together. Some people call it social self, social body. So to me, I think that's fundamental, because when we understand that we're interconnected inescapably, then we know we have a shared future. And so then the question is, do we want to intentionally build our shared future, or do we not want to build our shared future? So that leads us to the social choice, which is chaos or community. And for those that are choosing community, how do we live into that?
Why are you in Dayton and not some other place? What's up with that particular place? That this is the place that you've chosen to give your life to?
Well, hey, I was born here. I had been away, and then some people were kind of like, man, you do all this stuff nationally and internationally, but you're not doing much here. And I was like, but you got a point. And I was like, man, I'm gonna come back and kind of build a base here, and then I can go out, do whatever, and then come back. But the more I was here, the more I was like, man, this is the spot. The love that I was feeling, this, that, and the other. It's small enough to get things done. It's also big enough to get things done. I think Cincinnati a little bit harder, because it's like real big, or Columbus, or a bigger city. It's hard to make an impact. But Dayton, I think, is like the right size to like emerge something that can have a global impact. And we got the five rivers that meet here. There's a history of people coming together around this river in a sense of community. When I made those decisions, I had no idea about any of the stuff that's transforming now. Yeah, I just started to build deeper roots. And because of hyper-segregation, it's like, how do we actually heal this scenario? A lot of people in the East won't come West, and West won't go East, and there's all these myths and narratives about the different sides. And it's like, yo, we're all human. Like, what's his name? Fred Hampton. He's like, the rats on the east side are same size as the rats on the west side, you know?
One thing I really appreciate about you is the intentionality around language that you use. So you describe the Gem City Market as a community-driven effort to address food apartheid through a food co-op dedicated to increasing access to fresh fruits and vegetables within West Dayton. So I want to hear why you chose this word apartheid. I think anybody who hears that word, that jumps out to them. So why that word and not a food desert or something else that's more common to this conversation?
Well, shout out to Karen Washington for being the first one to coin the phrase food apartheid. I use apartheid because when you say desert, oftentimes it implies a natural phenomenon. Like, oh my gosh, I'm living in a food desert. And then over time, the system started using desert as a way to say underdeveloped. So you would have book deserts. You would have healthcare deserts, all these things that imply like, oh, dang, I live in an area that's a desert. And I know biologists don't like the word desert because desert has life too. I know that whole debate. But when I say food apartheid, I'm using that to show that it's actually by design, right? That some human being imagined this reality that we are living in right now. And if it's been imagined, then we can reimagine it. And that's how we realize power and release our hope. Because the more that I understand that I have the ability to shape and transform my lived environment, the more hopeful I become. And the more hopeful I become, the more I'm willing to put my gifts and talents into the center of the circle. And that's where the real power is generated, where a community believes in itself and believes in a shared future and develops its collective hope. Like, what is it that we can create together that inspires us? What is that compelling that like, yo, for this, I'm in. Here are my gifts and talents. Let's do this. And so how do we create those type of spaces? And so to me, language is key because language is the key to social transformation because it's the first impetus of social change. The language that you're using describes the context. It helps inform how you see each other, interact with each other, understand yourself. And so language is key. So like early on, we switched to food apartheid and been using it ever since.
As I read some of your stuff and listen to you, it feels like you have this theory of change that you probably would want a nuance, but in my mind, the way I'm conceptualizing it is that it starts with some vision of the future, some imagination of how things could be. You're using the beloved community here, but I think you could say Ubuntu or other things as well. That imagination, once it's taken root, produces some level of hope, and hope is a huge part of how you're thinking. Once hope is found, then we can pool our gifts and act together. So I'm thinking imagination, hope, gifts, action. Does that feel like a good kind of synthesis?
You know, no one's ever broken down like that. I appreciate that. I would say that, you know, especially radical imagination, the only thing I think I would add is participation. Because I think creating space for people to participate and co-create is the underlying glue that allows all those other things to come together. So I take the market. When it came to naming the market, the community named it. When it came to our mission statement, we had 200 people in the basement of Omega Baptist Church that helped come up with the mission statement together. Throughout the whole process, we were highly participatory because especially in areas that's been underdeveloped intentionally, sometimes we're overpromised and underdelivered. And that creates this sense of trauma, this sense of hopelessness. So getting people to act, getting people to be able to participate is key to activating the community. The underlying thing is trusting the people and creating a space for them to act and co-create together.
Yeah, I love that. I wrote down co-creation as the glue. I love that image. I was just incredibly struck by this process and your commitment to not letting idealism paralyze us. Because sometimes we have this vision of how things could be, and it's almost a way to defer our own agency. This otherworldly ideal that we can't actually ever achieve or even work together to accomplish. Mm-hmm. But you are committed to saying this is an ingredient that leads to co-created action.
Yeah.
Just talk for just a second. What does language specifically have to do with collective agency?
First thing that came to my mind right now is KRS-One got this album where it says, "World is mine."
You know, Whatever the brain doesn't have a word for, it can't see. I teach this all the time. The world is mine. M-I-N-D.
There were two. So it's like this notion of how like language and thought creates social reality, and knowing and grounding in that, because we got to look at like the meta narratives. What is the underlying assumptions that reality right now is based off of? Which I think right now was like sinking sand. It's fragile because it's not knowledge and the dignity and worth of every human being. So we built all these structures off of a false premise. That's why it's crumbling. And so it's rooting ourselves in our fundamental humanity is key. And language is a part of that, because I think we got to redefine what it means to be human. I think we need to redefine what it means to be Black, because Black has been a white imagination put upon Black people. And it's like, no, we are greater than your imagination of us. So how do we reimagine this? And the key thing is reimagining Black does not have to include the notion of race. We never created this hierarchy amongst human beings that said, oh, because of your skin color, you're inherently inferior or superior. And so in the process of reimagining Blackness, we reimagine what it means to be human. And then that is the catalyst for all the other change. So I think language is critical. And this challenging the underlying assumptions. I believe that there's over a billion people on this planet that believe love is supreme. We might not know what love is, but it's something inside that just feels like our North Star. And so it's like, yo, let's just take that. We don't know what it is. It's almost like Wizard of Oz. Let's just start walking towards it. Let's try to understand it. Because even while we're pressing to seek deeper love, love is actually drawing us back in. That's the glory of this hour. You know what I mean? The grace that we can't comprehend. And if love is supreme, John Coltrane, right? Is love our supreme? Like mine, Amaha. Is love my guiding principle, my guiding value? And how do we connect with others who have that same thing, that we can continue to reimagine how we are with each other and in the process reimagine the world? All these notions are critical, because to me, it's like we have to lay a different cornerstone on the earth. So in that sense, it's almost like a genesis, because there's periods and there's seasons, and we're coming off of COVID. And what is this new post-COVID world? How are we reimagining the world that we truly want to live in? Forget the status quo. What can we be together? How can we imagine these relationships with each other? Step by step, like in Ethiopia, we say, kas pa kas, slowly, slowly, the egg begins to walk. But yeah, I think the meta narratives are important, that language defines who we are to each other and who we are to ourselves. It situates the context. That's why I think indigenous knowledge is rising so much right now, because a lot of indigenous knowledge acknowledges our interdependence. It acknowledges that we're greater than this. And so, you know, truth crest of the earth is going to rise again.
I understand that you would want to define humanity and Blackness in a more of a collective way. And maybe it's not for you to define by yourself, but I would love to hear some tentative thoughts about what does a redefinition of Blackness and humanity look like? Do you have any particularities of what you think that could be?
I'm going to say like an earth worker, like someone that understands its connection to nature, like the sense of Ubuntu as a reality of how to live interdependently together. I'm just thinking of creation and imagination. There's a song where it talks about, instead of trying to obtain, achieving. Forever tangled web we weave, always trying to obtain, no attempt to achieve. Descendants of kings and queens act like justice. Never... If you look at some of the highlights in African history, like pyramids, never been enough. So like this notion of like doing and being, and I think humans are still human. There's going to be good and not good and all of these things. But I just want to get us out the box of our internalized oppression for Black people, that we're inherently inferior, that our ice is always warmer, that we expect all these negative things connected to our identity deep inside. So the healing process to me, like, yo, we can reimagine it together in the multiplicity of it. There's no homogenous human beings. There's not one definition of Blackness. But I think it's just showing up in the imagination that like, yo, I can like actually create and embody something greater than what these boxes and limitations have put upon myself. So I mean, for real, bro, I don't know what blackness means. That's a journey I think I'm on to try to understand for myself and live into, because I think the key right now, period, is that we got to show what is possible. We got to live into a new reality that contradicts the status quo, that people can have social choice, right? Because the social choice is, oh, I can stay status quo, or I can go this different path. But if the other path isn't made clear, not by words, but by demonstration and empower, then there is no social choice, because like the words ain't going to get it. It's by like living into something new. That's why I was saying earlier that those that are choosing community, we have to live into it in this hour. Like, yo, let's find out what the community is. Let's commit ourselves to it. Let's make that social choice that we can make the distinction that people that are on the fence and trying to figure out like, oh, this is compelling. This is something that I can be drawn into. This is something I can give my gifts and talents to. Let's try it. I don't know what will happen, but like choosing a different path.
I had a professor when I was in grad school. He talks about this idea of marred identity and how
you said marred identity?
Marred identity, M-A-R-E-D. Mm. Like the idea that like our concept of self has been wounded, right?
Yes,
and,
I love that.
And how we need to heal that self-identification in order to begin to find agency. You had this phrase in the article where you said that we need to be transformed into the protagonist in our own freedom journey.
Yeah.
So from a practical perspective, maybe from a story that you can remember, what does it look like for you to invite yourself and others to be the protagonist of their own freedom journey?
I think often we are recipients and not co-creators. So I think this whole process, how we transform recipients into co-creators. How are we the protagonists in our own story? How are we the authors? How are we self-determining our future instead of allowing others to create a future for us? And we just receive it and walk in it and accept it as what it is. It's really democracy on some level, but how do we truly live into our values and plot our future together by creating our own source on the west side of Dayton? How are we creating our own narrative? How are we truly moving forward in our self-determined way and then allowing everybody else to respond instead of other people telling us what we should do on the west side and who we are and all of these things? That's how we know our power. Like Ella Baker, she's one of my queen mothers, and she says strong people don't need strong leaders. So how are we leaderful? How are we knowing that, like, yo, we have the gifts and talents in our community, and if we bring those together, we can create something completely new and different? And that's why I think the relationship part is being a protagonist, because it's what got me into a lot of this work was just sensing that we were greater than what we were living, and it was our lack of relationship. We need to heal these relationships in order for us to move forward. Because when we bring our gifts together, talking about being a protagonist, like, I used to think opportunity was in structure, you know, like it was outside of ourselves. It's in the built lived environment, right? But actually, opportunity is in bringing our gifts together. And when we bring gifts together, like wheat connecting to wheat, when the wheat connects, it creates opportunity. The gifts coming together creates something new, and it creates potential, and it enables opportunity to be in existence. So part of being a protagonist, I think, is bringing our gifts together, because that's the power and the fuel of self-determination. That when we bring our gifts together towards a shared future, towards that collective hope, bringing the gifts like activates it, it gives it energy. That's why I think cooperation is like a moral force for human development, because the more we're bringing our gifts together, we're releasing this moral force on the earth.
In light of the recent controversy around her poetry, Amaha asked us to read a poem by Amanda Gorman. It's called New Day's Lyric. May this be the day we come together. Morning we come to mend. Withered we come to weather. Torn we come to tend. Battered we come to better. Tethered by this year of yearning, we are learning that though we weren't ready for this, we have been readied by it. We steadily vow that no matter how we are weighed down, we must always pave a way forward. This hope is our door, our portal. Even if we never get back to normal, someday we can venture beyond it to leave the known and take the first steps. So let us not return to what was normal, but reach toward what is next. What was cursed, we will cure. What was plagued, we will prove pure. Where we tend to argue, we will try to agree those fortunes we forswore, now the future we foresee. When we weren't aware, we're now awake. Those moments we missed are now these moments we make, the moments we meet, and our hearts altogether beaten, now altogether beat. Come, look up with kindness yet, for even solace can be sourced from sorrow. We remember not just for the sake of yesterday, but to take on tomorrow. We heed this old spirit in a new day's lyric, for when you honor yesterday, tomorrow we will find. Know what we fought need not be forgot, nor for none. It defines us, binds us as one. Come over, join this day just begun, for wherever we come together, we will forever overcome. Joey continues the conversation by asking Amaha a question.
So tell me a moment in your experience in Dayton where people's gifts were brought together and you said, oh my goodness, look at the creative force that this is as we come together. Gem City Market is obviously an example, but as particular as you can be, if you want to bring the names of particular neighbors into this space, feel free to do that. I would like to hear what it looks like on the ground for you in your life and work.
One moment that really stands out to me off the top of my head is the groundbreaking ceremony. We had raised the funds. Like, the whole process of the market was people working together. We had all the different committees. If it was Leela, Kenya, Fred, Erica, Rachel, all these people were coming together. Countless people, I couldn't even name them. But the groundbreaking ceremony, I think, was significant because typically, a groundbreaking ceremony, you have the mayor, maybe a couple other elected officials, and they got their shovels and they take the picture. And it was like, no, we got this far together. So our groundbreaking is going to be a community groundbreaking. We were like Oprah. Everybody had a shovel, from the babies of our totos all the way to the elders. Everybody had a shovel. There's this picture where it might be, you know, I don't know, 100 people, maybe more. And we all had a shovel in our hand. And that one stands out to me so much because that is what community looks like to me. It was people from all different types of backgrounds, identities, and we were all together in this space and we had worked together and we had made a significant achievement, which by the grace of the Most High will probably go down in history, at least Dayton history. And that moment just really stands out to me because it was like so many gifts made that moment possible. If it was knocking on doors, if it was our deep listening campaign, if it was the building community, the finance committee, all of these pieces had to come together to do what people said was impossible. Because building a store in a food apartheid area is no joke. It really has only been done a couple times in history in America. To get that far, when we started with zero grocery store experience, none of us had done anything but shop in a grocery store. So to me, that's an example of community power, a sense of place in community, and our ability to determine our future together.
That's amazing. I love the image of everybody having a shovel. In your work, as you encounter somebody who you want to enlist in the collective effort that you're a part of, what does it look like to locate those people's gifts? Do they self-identify it? Are you calling it out of people when you see it? What does it practically look like to identify the gifts of others?
Yeah, it's probably a both and. I remember one time, by the grace of God, I was getting an award like 3 years ago, maybe 4 years ago. And the question was raised, how do you do so much? And I never thought about it before. And I was like, I think it's because any work that is for the common good, I see me being a part of. I don't have to know you, but just the fact that you're doing that, I know we're on the same team in some kind of way. And I know our works are accelerating each other. And so that's kind of how I organize. So when I meet somebody, sometimes they'll say like, hey, I do this or I do that. And then I'll connect them with somebody. Oh, have you met so-and-so? Or have you talked to so-and-so? Or, oh man, I need to introduce you to this person. Or I'll be like, oh man, for real? We've been trying to do this, this, and this. Maybe you could help out with that. Or sometimes I think like going back to that marred identity, the sense of competition that we have amongst each other, where instead of like seeing our gifts as assets that are to be shared and acknowledged. We try to compete against each other. So I'll push down your gifts so my gifts shine brighter. Because of the trauma that comes from that, I think we don't fully understand the gifts that we're bringing, or we're even afraid to say it. Even myself, you mentioned earlier something about courage. Like, for me to talk about beloved community, it was a process, because it's a certain type of boldness to call for this type of reality. And I was scared to do it. I felt it inside, but I wasn't going to say it vocally. So sometimes, yeah, I'll see how they work. I'm like, man, like, I don't know if you've seen this, but you got this gift as well. Like, oh, you're real good at bringing people together. You're good with administration, or you're good at this and that. And so I think we all help each other realize how we show up in space. But oftentimes people, at least in the beginning, will like share what they do or what their passion is. Like my good sister, Tadril, she's always talking about how we got to connect people by their passions. What are the things that they want to do from deep down inside, and creating space for that? Another part I want to add to your theory earlier is, who are the knowledge creators? Because oftentimes we see knowledge creators are people in academia or people that have quote unquote formal power, instead of seeing the knowledge creators as the people with the lived experience. So someone in the community that has not a lot of formal education, but been on the block for 30, 40 years, they have more knowledge than the PhD will ever have of their neighborhood. The people closest to the issue understand the issue the most. So how do we center the voice of the community inside of public policy, inside of the direction that we're trying to go, right? You know, understand it and then use that as our guidance system towards what it is that we're trying to do and create together. So I think like, the importance of community voice, it's like the root, because we have to act from our lived experience. And that's why, like, you know, Paulo Freire will talk about being subjects and not objects. Part of that being a subject is it acknowledging the voice of local experience.
I saw that some of the work that you're doing is with an after-school summer program, West Dayton Strong. And I think there's something so incredibly powerful to be able to identify the gifts and strengths of young people. That is an act, in my mind, of restoring people's self-identification. Mm-hmm. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, adults have to unlearn a lot, whereas youth, they're just learning. And so, like, how do we create spaces where walking in their full gifts is just natural? It's who you are and what you do, and how to bring that out early instead of, like, having to unlearn all these things later in life. How do we create opportunity? And especially youth that have been dealing with a lot of trauma, how to help them see their gifts and their potential. There's a story, I'm not going to use his name, but there's a young brethren in our program that was experiencing heavy, 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 unfathomable levels of trauma. And because of that, he would regularly act out. And we use trauma-informed care. So you might get kicked out for the day, but you came back tomorrow and it was like nothing happened. You just keep moving. But one day, I started noticing when it came time to do puzzles, he would walk around the room and do multiple puzzles. Like some people play multiple chessboards. He would just walk around the room, put a puzzle piece here, walk around the room, put a puzzle piece here. It was like, man, he could code. If we got him situated to learn coding language and stuff, he would be gangster at this. So it was like helping him find some of his gifts and talents and ways to use himself. Interestingly enough, at a side note, West Dayton Strong grew out of this relationship with Robbie Brandon and Tiffany Brown. I was doing my grad research and we were in DeSoto Bass to understand. All of West Dayton was labeled low opportunity, but I wanted to understand what that actually means. So we talk about food apartheid, we talk about all these things, right? But what does that mean for someone in their day-to-day experience? So I went to DeSoto Bass Public Housing and we did these focus groups. In our very first focus group, we were talking and people were sharing their ideas and this, that, and other. And then Miss Donna, who's like the mother of West Dayton Strong, she was like, you know what? A couple kids, they come to my house and we do a little Bible study and I help them with their homework a little bit. And then in that moment, it was like, okay, I can either just be like the researcher or I can put on my organizer hat, right? And so I put on my organizer hat. We started talking more. And that was the foundation for West Dayton Strong. It was purely something that came out of community initiative. Because at that time, there was no free after school or summer programs for all these youth. At that time, there was a huge after school program that basically didn't let our kids in because they couldn't afford it. So it was purely a grassroots effort. So you're talking about how those gifts came together. West Staten Strong is another great example. That happened, like, that was not planned. I went to this meeting just thinking I'm gonna finish my grad paper. And then I literally got my degree the same day we launched West Staten Strong because it was like beginning of summer. And I literally left from getting my degree and went to do West Staten Strong the same day.
Thanks for listening. Check the show notes for more info about Amaha, the Gem City Market, and West Staten Strong. This episode has been hosted by me, Rabbi Miriam Turlinsham, and produced by the amazing Joey Taylor, and music is from Jeff Gorman.